Well, good morning and welcome to Crossway. We are so happy that you're here with us this morning on a nice cold and frosty Sunday. Man, how do I put this, Fred? As a larger individual, I enjoy the cold weather. Yeah, it's man weather. And so some of you that don't enjoy it as much, well, Thanksgiving is this week, and you have an opportunity to rectify that by eating a lot of pie, all right? And so, but we're happy that you're here with us on a cool morning. At least it's warm in the house of the Lord, and so we're glad that you're here. First off, if you're a visitor in our church, you're here for the first or second time, not a regular attender, if you could do this for us, and the chair back in front of you is one of these cards. It's a visitor's information card, just a way for us to have a record of your attendance with us today. But what we're asking you to do, if you will fill that out, and then before you leave the building today, as you're going towards the main exits, to the left, there's a place that we call Connection Corner. One of our deacons, elders, or staff will be there to be able to meet you, greet you, talk with you, see if there's any questions that you have. We've got a gift to be able to give you, and so we want to be able to give you that gift today. So if you could do that for us and then meet us after church, we would love to get to know you a little bit. Also, today, different things that we have going on. First of all, if you're one of our deacons, whether you're a new deacon coming on or you're one of our current deacons, you have a training today at 3 o'clock in the fellowship hall, so don't forget about that. And then tonight is our last night of D groups, and so we're into our winter calendar and getting ready for all the activities that we have on Sunday nights through December and January. And so tonight is that last night when our D groups meet, but don't worry, we'll get back to it at the end of January. Also, this week, because it is Thanksgiving week, our office is going to be open all day Monday and Tuesday, but only open till noon on Wednesday. But that doesn't mean that you can't get a hold of us. Please, you know, send us a message, call us, whatever else. And then, as I say, I try to pick, one person in particular. I don't see Corey in here, but if you need something, call Corey. Stop by his house. You get a toilet clogged up, you need someone to help bring firewood in, call Corey. He would be more than willing to come over and help you, but tell him that Ryan sent him, so that way he doesn't know it was me. But also that means that this week on Tuesday is the time we're having our annual community Thanksgiving service. Great time of worship and fellowship with other churches in our community. And that'll be at 7 o'clock on Tuesday at Free Will. And so we're asking that you join us there for that time of worship. And then if you've signed up to help with our Thanksgiving meal, that will be happening on Thursday from 10:30 to 12:30. And so again, a great opportunity to reach out into our community, provide a Thanksgiving meal for those that can't go back home or don't have the means to be able to do that. And if you would, sometimes I'm not exactly sure where all we're at with the food and volunteers and that. And so if you would, if you haven't signed up for a way to be able to help, if you could stop by Connection Corner before you leave and sign up to help in some way. But one of the best things that you can do is also pray for that day and for the contacts that are made and for the lives that can be changed just through simple things like a Thanksgiving meal. And so, and last but certainly not least, next week, you guys are all invited. We're having our annual lunch slash decoration of the church. Next Sunday morning after this service, we're going to be having a fellowship meal for everybody. I believe this year we're doing some pasta. We've done different things in the past with chews. That's like two things put together. That's stew and chili, all right? And so you chew it up and then you swallow it and then it's a whole other thing. But we've had fajitas and other things. So this year we said, hey, let's go with the Italian touch. We're going to have some pasta. And so we're asking you guys to join us for a free lunch and then stick around a little bit afterwards and help us decorate the church. The more people we have come help, the better we can do things. And so we want to make our church beautiful during the Christmas season. And so next Sunday is when we get to do that. And so if you'll stick around and help us, that would be fantastic. Well, we'll get into our service now. We're going to turn it over to our worship team after a word of prayer. So bow with me as we go to the Lord. Father God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity that we have, the freedom that we have to come into your home, God, and to sing praises and to hear your word preached. And so, God, I pray that as we come today, that we would come with hearts ready and minds that aren't distracted by things of the world, God, that aren't, God, being just pushed aside by the things that are so easy for us to be distracted by. So, God, I pray that you would help us to focus on you today. The words that you have for us that would challenge our spirits and our minds to make us better servants for you. And that, God, as we hear these things and we are challenged by these things, that we would take it out to the world that's around us and make a positive difference for you. So, God, be with us today. Help us to experience you in a mighty and a powerful way. God, may you become greater as we become less. In your Son's holy and precious name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning, everybody. It's great to be here with you at Crossway this morning. If you'll stand with us, we're going to begin our time of worship together today. Celebrate that our Savior is living today. Amen. See the tomb where he laid. See the stone rolled away. He is risen. He is risen. He's alive. See his hands. See his feet, touch his scars and believe. He is risen, he is risen, he's alive. Oh, he's alive. He lives. All honor and power are his. All glory. Jesus. Amen. That's a reason that we can sing joyfully today in this place. Our Savior is risen. Amen. Let's sing it. You took all our shame. You left it in the grave. We're forgiven. We're forgiven. The work forever done. Only by the blood. It is finished. Yes, it is finished. Oh, you took all our shame. Left it in the grave. Praise you today, Father, and we thank you that you conquered the grave on our behalf, Lord. We thank you, and we pray that today you would bless this time of offering as we continue our worship. It's in Jesus' holy name. Amen. You may be seated this morning if you have offerings or if you'd like to pray. Our altars are open.
Good morning. Our scripture today is from Revelation's second chapter, verses 8 through 11. And to the angel of the church in Smyrna write the words of the first and the last who died and came to life. I know your tribulation and your poverty, but you are rich, and the slander of those who say that they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and for 10 days you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who conquers will not be hurt by the second death. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, our hearts are full of gratitude today. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the plan of salvation, for the promise of eternal life. Father, we pray that you'd bless our service today. Father, bless those in our service today who are suffering. I pray that you would comfort them as only you can. I pray that you'd bless Bill as he brings a word today, Father, that our hearts would be ready to listen to what you have to say to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Will you stand with us again as we sing, "Who the Son Sets Free is Free Indeed"? Let's sing this.
Glad to be a child of God this morning. Amen.
Should I?
Thank you that you're a light that shines in the darkness. Lord, as we sing this next song, we sing, "It is well with my soul." God, in the midst of our suffering and our struggle, God, you're in control. Lord, you have us. We trust you.
When peace like a I
Proclaim those words, and we thank you for your Son. It's in Jesus' holy name. Amen. You may be seated.
Great job, worship team. Thank you. We're going to be in the book of Revelation, chapter 2, verses 8 through 11. That's on page 1028 and 1029 of the Bible in the chair in front of you. And we're looking at the seven churches of Revelation that John writes to. And we looked at Ephesus last week. They proclaimed their love for the Lord, but not first. Okay, so this week we're going to look at the church of Smyrna. Smyrna says, I love the Lord, but who wants to suffer? Right? Yeah, I love the Lord, but who wants to suffer? All right, so just so you know, it's a gigantic responsibility to stand here. It's not something I take lightly. Because I'm proposing to speak, I'm suggesting that I'm speaking God's word. So what comes out of my mouth needs to be accurate. All right? So if it's not, then I'm in way bigger trouble than with you. Okay? So I just want you to know that I'm humbled to get to do that. And I'm not worthy, that's for sure, okay? But just keep this in mind. It's important that you pray that God would speak, not me, all right? That's just how we need to see it. So the community of Smyrna today is a city by the name of Izmir, all right? It's in Turkey. It's one of the oldest continually inhabited cities in the world. The population of this community today is about roughly, and this was several years ago, but I'd say in the last 15 years, 4 million people. Now, in the ancient world, this city had a beauty about it. It was a planned and arranged city. So it was considered to be, in fact, it was referred to as the glory of Asia. It was a beautiful city. The most famous person that we know from this community, this city, was, and he was the leader of this church, he was the Bishop of Smyrna. You may have heard of his name if you studied any of church history, Christian history, than you have. If you haven't, then you're probably, he's probably, his name is probably somewhat foreign to you. But his name was Polycarp, okay? Like a lot of carp, you know what I'm saying? Polycarp, I'm kidding, but Polycarp. Polycarp, why is he famous? Well, he's famous in church history because he was a disciple of John the Apostle. So the writer of Revelation, okay, God used John. Now, this is the revelation of Jesus, but John is the penman, okay? He's the one that wrote it. And Polycarp was one of his disciples. He studied at the feet of John. Now, he's revered because he was the last one connected to an apostle to live. He died in 155 A.D., but he was the last one directly connected to an apostle as far as training that we know of. So he's a big shot, okay? He's a big guy. He's important. He was also, however, friends with Ignatius. Now, if you don't study heaven church, study church history, you don't know who that is. But Ignatius was the bishop of Antioch. So he has connections going back into the first century and forward into the late second century. So he's the connecting point, one of the connecting points, a strong one, between the apostles of Jesus and the later church fathers. All right? He was 86 years old when he died. Now, I'm going to spend some time talking about him and what that means for us, because he was such an important figure in this church. I'll get into the passage shortly. So what I'm telling you is not fairy tale. It's historically documented, okay? Well documented, by the way. He was martyred in 155 when he was 86 years old. By the way, we know this from eyewitness account, okay, from an eyewitness account. And also the early church fathers testify to this. So it's not some one-off where some website mentioned it one time, okay? That's not what it is. During this time when Polycarp is executed, he's burned at the stake, Antoninus Pius was the emperor. Now, Antoninus Pius was basically following the policy laid down earlier by Trajan and then Hadrian. And it was basically this: do not pursue Christians, but if they are accused or stir up trouble, pretty much take them out. So, first century believers were under this pressure to worship either the Roman gods or the emperor as God, one of those two. Now, a lot of scholars, I would say the weight of scholarship is that, at least from my perspective, is that often this persecution took on an economic, had an economic facet to it. You didn't follow the party line, then you would lose your job. If you had a business and you did not follow the party line, then you would not be dealt with by the powers that be financially, but also they would discourage others from trading with you lest they also be persecuted. Okay, so it could really leave you in a lurch financially very quickly. Now, it's interesting, I read an interview with a guy who was born in Kenya, and when he was very young child or baby maybe, his parents immigrated to the United States. And then as a teenager, he went back to visit in Kenya, and all the family gathered there in Kenya, and he noticed whenever politics came up, they stopped laughing and talking and started whispering. And he thought, that's interesting. We don't do that in America. We just say it. Now, flash forward 25 years, his daughter, who's a high school student, really recently shushed him. Okay? I don't know if you've ever been shushed by a teenager, but can't be an encouraging thing, right? Okay, so he's shushed. I was shushed by mine a few times because I was being a bit redneck maybe, okay? But anyway, okay? So they'd go, shh, Dad, shh, Dad. What? You know, but anyway. So he gets shushed. And she said, someone might hear you say that and you'll be canceled. He thought, how quickly things have changed. When he was a teenager, you could say what you wanted to and no one thought anything about it. And he said, now you can't do that, lest you be canceled. So I wrote this thought down. Freedom can be lost in a moment, and all it takes is for one generation to fail to defend it. Right? So in Smyrna, this is what's going on. It's a canceling of this church, and it's costing them economically tremendously. You see, power is addictive. It is. I confess that. It is addictive to me. I think it's addictive to many people, probably most people, we could say. My observation is that political parties often lust for power more than they lust for service to others. That's just my take. And if I've offended you and your group, I'm sorry. But there are those who, in order to gain power, work to cancel anyone who dares to challenge the status quo. And actually want to cancel everyone who dares to speak a line that's not been approved as an acceptable line. So Polycarp goes there. That's what he does. Okay? At the age of 86, he's arrested. Why? He won't sing the party line. And he's given, though, an opportunity to swear allegiance to the gods of Rome as they're preparing to burn him at the stake. Now, there's all sorts of mythological things coming out that he was so pure he wouldn't burn and they had to do something else. And all most of that's baloney, okay? I don't find any historical evidence of that. However, he was burned at the stake. He did get an opportunity to retreat from his stand. He refused. In fact, they begged him to swear allegiance to the Roman gods and he would be spared. And here are his words as written down by an eyewitness. For 86 years I have been his servant, and he has done me no wrong. How can I blaspheme my king who saved me? And he was executed for refusing to repeat the party line. So here's what's happened. The people of Smyrna, the church in Smyrna, has effectively been canceled economically, but they wouldn't shut up. So Rome says, okay, here's how we'll fix this. We'll execute their leader. That'll shut them down. It didn't. At least at the moment, it didn't. But here's what Jesus said in general to his followers, which I hope includes you this morning. If the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Now Jesus is looking ahead for those who follow him, and he's saying, this worldly system is going to hate you at times. Don't be surprised when this happens. So, just in passing, today if I were to, and I'm uninterested in doing this by the way, but if I were to somehow by 30 minutes of time on a major network. And on that, during that 30 minutes of time, I shared the biblical, what I believe to be the biblical views on a number of subjects. Let's say salvation, creation, marriage, sex, gender, ethnicity, war, the environment, utilizing what God has provided, things like fossil fuel, eating meat, okay? That's a big crime, right? Okay. And just about every topic being talked about today, just so you know, that would put me at odds with millions of people. It would. I mean, if I really said what I thought God teaches and God says, it would put me at odds with millions of people. Now, it can be really intimidating when people start to come at you. You know, I wrote a little something a few years ago about the legalization of marijuana in our state. And I wrote it as saying, listen, I understand there's medicinal values, there's other things that are good, that can be, marijuana can be used that are good, But I said, this bill is a bad bill. Of course, now every one of their dogs, even the people growing it, are saying, that was a bad bill, okay? But at the time, within a few hours, we got 48,000 responses on our webpage. They didn't like my words, okay? And I was gracious, but they didn't like it. So it can be a bit intimidating, okay, when that happens to you. But here's the real tough part for me. Not acting like they do when I respond back, right? Because I'm telling you, I can, yah, with the best of them, right? Okay, it's in me. I admit that. I'm not proud of that, but I admit once the barometer, you know, once the old pressure gauge gets to a certain point, I go, okay, I'm done, idiot. Okay, that's just what comes out. That's what happens. I'm not saying that's good. So one of the biggest challenges sometimes is not to become like them, right? God clearly gave us a command to care for this earth. We should do that faithfully. When we make ourselves out, though, to be God, I have to save the planet, we cross the line. Jesus got stirred up a few times, not often. It appears to me that he gets stirred up when religious people pretend to be spiritual and they're not. Okay, he calls them snakes. He's pretty straight with them. And then when he finds people in the outer court of the temple, the only place Gentiles could come to worship, and they've made it a carnival, or more specifically, they've given certain connected Jewish merchants rights to come in and cheat people and justify it. And he cleans house. He cleans house. So there's a time to stand up and be bold, and there's a time to accept what's being done to you. I don't claim to tell you this morning exactly where the dividing line is, but I know sometimes we have to just take it, and sometimes we have to say, no, this is not right. Okay? So write this down, point number one, as we look at just a thumbnail sketch of Polycarp, write this down. We live in a world desperate for devotion. We live in a world desperate for devotion. We almost teach and preach as a society in opposition to devotion. For instance, we're desperate for husbands to be devoted to their wives. We're desperate for wives to be devoted to their husbands. We live in a society that's desperate for children to be devoted to their parents, for leaders to be devoted to their citizens, for teachers to be devoted to their students, and students to be devoted to their studies, and workers to be devoted to their task. We're desperate for devotion. In our society, marriage is shrinking. The marriage rate fell to the lowest level. And I've read several articles about this, but basically it's the lowest level since they've been measuring it. You say, now, wait a minute, I'm single and I'm, okay, the Bible speaks of some being born to be single. I'm good with that. That's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about those who do not claim to be born to be single but are not devoted. We're desperate for devotion. As people, we want what we want and we don't want to commit to anyone but ourselves. Now, today, much of our population believes that they deserve a certain level of affluence. You know, I deserve that. I should be able to live at this level. Now, don't get me wrong. I love rags to riches stories about men and women who've risked everything to make it in business, or they were the underdog and they made it in sports, even being an underdog. I love those stories. They worked 18-hour days, or they went far beyond what anyone else was willing to do. Well, here's what we learned from the life of Polycarp. The great men and women of God were devoted. They were willing to give up everything they had, including their lives, in order to plant seeds for all of eternity. That's what they were willing to do. When they were threatened with their life, they said, look, you can kill me, but I'm not changing my mind. What's right is right, and what's true is true. Polycarp is a giant of the faith. He knew that the gospel message was true. He'd spent his young years learning at the feet of John the Apostle, and he'd spent, we know, now here's how we know this, he wrote a letter in 110 talking about the people where he was serving in Smyrna. So we know from 110 to 155, he served in this church. We don't know for sure if he was the pastor or the bishop here in 95 when this was written, but we know he was for 45 years. He was faithful. Man, he was devoted. He was devoted to this church. He was devoted to his God, to his church, to these people. He was devoted. Write this down, letter A. This church had a leader rich in faith. You know what? Some things we don't know about Polycarp. We don't know if he was eloquent. We don't know. I don't even know if we have a sermon of his. We don't know if he was eloquent. We don't know if he was good looking. I mean, he might have looked like homemade soap. I don't know. I mean, he might scare the ticks off a dog. We don't know. He might have been, you know, he might have been Elvis. I don't know. I mean, he might have been great looking. He might have been ugly. I don't know. We don't know. We don't know if he had a great voice. The other day, one Sunday afternoon here recently, we had a Native American church. They come and baptize people sometime in our baptistry on Sunday afternoons. They had a guy in there when he walked in. I don't even think I can do it. I've got a pretty deep voice, but his voice was like a cannon. It was like, whoa, he was just talking. It was just like, boom. And I went, man, that guy, I wish I had that guy's voice. Man, that guy, I mean, when he talks, everyone goes, okay. And the people, there was a party going on right next to the Baptist church, so we had to pull this little petition across. And the people in the party probably thought God was talking, I mean, because he'd say, have you received the Lord? You know, and everyone in there was doing this, okay. Well, we don't know what this guy's voice was like. But you know what we know? We know this. We know when they said, you can either pledge your allegiance to the Roman gods and the Roman emperor, or we're going to burn you at the stake. He said, come on, baby, light my fire. Pretty much, right? He wasn't changing. Wow, what a guy. We don't know. Could he have gotten a better job than this one? I don't know. Maybe, but he obviously believed that his call was to Jesus Christ in this church. He knew that God had placed him in this church, in this city. Nothing would budge him except the Lord himself. I challenged a guy that I met with here a couple weeks ago, and he's a good guy, and I was just trying to encourage him. I wasn't trying to put it on him or anything, but I said, buddy, have you come here to die? I want to know that. I want to know what you think. Have you come here to this place to die? And he kind of, whoa, I don't know about dying. I mean, I said, have you come here to die? Because, see, I believe God called me here to die. You say, oh, no, this guy will still be trying to get up there when he's 90? No, I don't mean that. I mean, he called me to pour myself out to do what needs to be done here. I'm not distracted by other things or opportunities or nothing. Who cares? I'm as uninterested as I am in the measles. Are you kidding me? I'm not interested in that. I want to make sure that every bit is poured out in this specific work that he's given me to do. Now, on the flip side, do I want to ignore people sometimes?
Mm-hmm.
Do I want to hide sometimes? Mm-hmm. Do I want to run sometimes? Mm-hmm. But think about it this way. Since Jesus gave his all for us, would it not be right for us to give our all back to him? So Polycarp said, how can I not give him all for what he's done for me? Wow. Something changed in this city over the course of time. Now it's Muslim, but it's pretty much secular. There's about 12 churches located there. Okay, most of them are Greek Orthodox or Catholic, Roman Catholic. Okay, they say people that have keep up with the numbers say they think there's about 500 who profess Christ in this city now, out of 4 million. And out of that 500, a tiny little group would call themselves Protestants. Okay? So when we add up all those who claim to be Christians in this city today, we come up with about 1/80th of 1%, only a tiny fraction. So let's take a look at the passage. And to the angel of the church at Smyrna write the words of the first and the last who died and came to life. By the way, that's the words of Jesus. I know your tribulation and your poverty, but you are rich. Letter B, write this down. This church had a congregation rich in faith. I know your tribulation. So Jesus says, I know what you're going through. Now, I try to be careful when I'm consoling someone who's lost something or someone and they're hurting. I try not to say, I know how you feel, if I don't. If I've never experienced what they're experiencing, I try consciously, don't say that. Say, look, I've been through something similar. I understand the feelings of grief, but I don't know how you feel. But Jesus knows how you feel. I want you to know that this morning. Have you ever felt like the world was against you? Take heart. Jesus knows the feeling. And yes, if you're a faithful believer, then the world is against you. These saints in Smyrna were being mistreated by those in power. The Romans were in power. They were these persecuting the saints there could be those demanding that the Roman gods be worshipped or those demanding emperor worship. We don't know which one. The saints in Smyrna worshiped God and God alone, and it cost them. It will also cost you. They were being denied work, denied whatever they could be denied. Food, water, like the woman at the well. You can only come to the well certain times of the day. Christian standards should be so much different than the standards of the world. So here's what I want you to know today. I want to declare this so everyone will know. I am one rich dude. I am. If you don't believe me, just watch when I drive off today, okay? All right? That's a joke. Here's why I'm rich. Because my life is full and running over with great friends. It's full and running over. In fact, it's so full and running over, I'm amazed at how rich I am. And you know what? There's a pretty good group of those friends that actually like me. And that's good, right? I'm not the easiest guy on the planet to like. But no amount of money in the world can take the place of my friends. I had a birthday this past week. I don't talk about my birthday. I don't announce it. I'm kind of one of those guys that think maybe this will get by and no one will notice. But my wife goes to the social media and it's my life is over for a few hours, okay? Okay? I'm not mad about it. It's actually, for me, it's embarrassing. People are so gracious and so kind and so loving and so encouraging, and I don't deserve none of it, and I'm just humbled by the outpouring. But I just want you to know I'm one of the richest men on the planet. Bill Gates ain't got nothing on me. I just want you to know that. I'm so humbled by the kindness shown toward me. I want you to know something. I love this place. I love this place. But I want you to know something else. I love this place too. This place called Smyrna. This place called Smyrna. Why? Because they had things right. This church was rich in what mattered. Now, to quote my mom, I've quoted her before. I've quoted this before. They didn't have a pot to pee in, but they were rich. They were rich. You see, if you've not figured this out yet, the world can justify just about anything. Often Christians can also be found trying to justify their pagan ways. Everyone else is doing it, right? We so want to be accepted by the world. One of my friends once said to me, "We're average guys. We're decent guys. We must be going to heaven. If we're not, who is?" And I said, "Well, I think it's by faith, brother." And he said, "So, you think you're going and I'm not? Let me tell you something, I'm as good as you are." He was right. He was right. I wasn't living for the Lord. I was probably worse than him. This should never be. But the result of the faithfulness of these people living in Smyrna is that they were suffering tribulation. So what do we hear? The direct result of faithfulness was tribulation. Direct result. Faithfulness brought tribulation. In fact, we could even use the word suffering. Because of their faithfulness, they were suffering. Who's signing up for that? Right? Because of their faithfulness, they were suffering. It was really tough. Then he says, "I know your tribulation. I know your poverty." By the way, the Greek word here for poverty is destitute, abject poverty. They were suffering. It was tough. And how were they doing it? They were doing it economically. They weren't giving it. They weren't letting them work. They weren't letting them sell their goods. They were struggling. They were, and honestly, what they were probably doing was swapping among themselves. They had something I didn't have, so we swapped. And that's a bartering's only way they could do it, because they couldn't belong to the economic system. They had been left out. Then he says these words: I know your tribulation, I know your poverty, but you're rich. Then he says, and the slander of those who say they're Jews are not, but are of the synagogue of Satan. Write this down, let her see. This church had powerful enemies. The more that a church lives out the truth of the gospel, the more enemies they're going to have. If we go along as a church with everything that's happening in the culture and we just kind of turn a blind eye, things are great. People go, they're so wonderful. The moment that we say, no, that does not honor our God, we become a target. Notice the word slander. So we know that what was being said about this church is a lie, but it's being accepted by the community. Sound familiar? Tell me that's not going on. See, the Jews had disdain for the pagans, but they hated Christians. There's a difference. Pagans weren't a threat. They didn't see them as a threat. They saw Christians as a threat. Why? Because Jews were coming to faith. The pagans were pagans. Okay? They were pagans. No threat. Devoted Christians were sharing their faith and bringing others into the fold. Now, there's a couple of theories about who these Jews were. I don't know who they were for sure, but here's what we know. Some say they were Jews by birth, but not by faith. And some say, no, they weren't really Jews. They've been brought into Judaism by joining the Judaism train, but they weren't really Jews, so I don't know who they were, but here's what we know. They belong to Satan. That's enough. I don't need to know anymore. They belong to Satan. So notice the word, let's go, who's the father of lies? Well, Jesus said it was Satan, right? Jesus said that Satan was the father of lies. So when you find someone who's habitually not being truthful, ooh. In fact, when one of those words comes out of your mouth that's not truthful, who can we pretty much consider as having an influence? You know, right? He's the father of that stuff. So these people who were claiming to be spiritual and claiming to be religious and claiming to have a legitimate argument with the people in the church at Smyrna, the truth is they were followers of Satan, whether they knew it or not. We do know from eyewitness account, that the Jews were cheering on the execution of Polycarp when he was executed. They were not about Jesus. They were about a religious system. You know, I admit to you today that sometimes I'm leery of religious systems. Now, once again, I would agree with this. I think this is a great principle, that when religious groups can cooperate together behind common goals, that they can do a lot more together than they can do apart. Okay, here's my concern a little bit. What happens, I think, sometimes is the cooperation becomes more important than what we're cooperating about. In other words, it almost gets down to just send us the money. Shut up and send us the money. We'll decide how it's spent. Time out. Okay? So sometimes that the corruption can get involved in that. All right? And here's what happens. The main thing stops being the main thing. It quickly becomes the pursuit of cash. And those who give the most get promoted the most. Verse 10. Do not fear what you're about to suffer. Uh-oh. He's already told them you're about to suffer. Don't fear. Don't be afraid. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison, that you may be tested. So there's a purpose for the prison. And for 10 days you'll have tribulation. Be faithful unto death. I will give you the crown of life. So we live in a world desperate for devotion. Write this down, number two. We live in a world desperate for courage. This church was courageous. He says, I know your tribulation. I know your poverty. I know they're lying about you. Oh, by the way, it's about to get worse. Huh? What? That's a note of encouragement, right? Okay, I know you're being hammered. You're broke. And they're lying about you. But it's going to get a little bit worse. That's what he says. Courage is not an absence of fear. Courage is determined action in the face of fear. The words of Jesus here refer to what is about to come for this church. What's coming? What's coming is not just the oppression that they've already been experiencing, but some are about to be thrown into prison. What great news, huh? I know that it's bad, but take heart. It's about to get worse. That's what he says to them. Now, Jesus clearly states that this prison sentence is for testing. He's throwing these believers. He says Satan's going to put them in prison. So what does that mean? If he's a sovereign God, and he is, he's going to allow this. So there's a purpose for it. What does he tell us? Well, it's testing. It's getting them prepared for worse days ahead. He's toughening them up. If you've ever been involved in a sport in some kind, then often early season, before the season actually starts, okay, there's a lot of conditioning going on. And I did a lot of different sports through my life, okay? Okay, and here's what I noticed. We always had some peel off during conditioning days, right? Remember that, Fred? They just peel off. Now, some, because they decided they didn't like it. That's okay. I'm good with that. But some went, I sure do love this, but I ain't doing this. It's too hard. It makes me tired. I almost cried. Whatever. Okay? And so they left. Okay? And so I'd go home at night and pray to get tougher so Mormon quit so I'd get to play. You say, you didn't really do that, did you? Yeah! Okay? But here's the thing. So why is he putting them in prison? Why is God allowing them to be put in prison? He says, for testing. It's to get them prepared for the tough days ahead. But there's another reason for the testing, too. You find out who's really in. Yeah. You find out who's really in. See, you have some who love potluck dinners, but they ain't taking a stand over nothing, right? There's a difference. The first tribulation is only going to last 10 days. Now, we're not sure about this 10 days. Is it literal? Could be. I'm not offended if it is. Okay, it seems to me that the weight of scholarship kind of comes down on the side that it's symbolic for, it's short. This persecution coming up is not going to be long for you. Probably a Roman ruler would change, and it would change the trajectory. All right? One emperor would be a hands-off guy. The next one would come after him. So it's probably, he's saying, listen, get ready. The suffering's coming. It's not going to be long. It's going to be a time of testing for you. It's going to toughen up those who are truly believers. And the ones that aren't, it's going to reveal their fraudulency, so to speak. And 60 years from when this was written, Polycarp, their teacher and spiritual leader, is going to be burned at the stake before their eyes. And many of these who are hearing this letter probably read to them in this church won't be there when Polycarp is executed. They've already died. John is gone. They'll be gone. But their leader will still be there 60 years later and still be reminding them to be prepared. Write this down, letter A. The challenge for every church at every time is obedience, is to be obedient, is to be obedient. I would wager that if I did an in-depth investigation, I could find unbiblical things going on in most families in some fashion, most businesses in our city, our county. And I'm not suggesting that I should investigate, because I'm simply admitting that this battle is going on everywhere all the time, including in my life and in my house. All right? And yes, inside God's church, that's a battle. We must hold to God's truth. Here's what Jesus said in John 14, 15. If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. If you love me, let me rephrase that. If you love me, you'll do what I tell you. If you love me, you'll hold firm to what I've taught you. Our obedience then displays our commitment to Jesus. Praise is important, but it's not the test. Faithfulness to church is good, but it's not the test. Hard work within the church is wonderful, but it's not the test. Obedience to Him and love for each other when the world is against you are the ultimate test. Letter B, write this down. The faithful, he says, will receive the crown of life. Now, this is not suggesting that some have qualified, but they have to keep doing certain things in order to get in. That's not it. Those who truly belong to Jesus will be faithful unto death, and they will receive the crown, which here is eternal life. their faithfulness would show who they belong to, and they would receive eternal life. So verse 11, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who conquers will not be hurt by the second death. The one who conquers will not be hurt by the second death. So write this down, letter C. The second death has no power over believers. The second death has no power over believers. With the exception of those alive, when the rapture takes place, all will taste death. You will experience the first death, which is physical death. You will. If Jesus is your Lord and Savior today, meaning you've recognized your sin, your need for Him, you've placed your faith in Him for the forgiveness of your sins, then you, now listen, you will not experience the second death. You will not, because you're saved. I'm a conqueror. This passage speaks of conqueror. I'm a conqueror for one simple reason. Jesus chose me, He called me out, and He saved me by faith. I have the status of a conqueror, not because of me, because of Him. By His power, death, the grave, and sin have all been defeated. This poor church in our story, the church at Smyrna, had what's important for a church to have. And you know what Jesus said? That church is rich. So I got to tell you today, without hesitation, I know there's at least one, I think there's three or four around that don't go here that say, yeah, that's the rich church. Okay? And that's fine. That doesn't offend me. They don't know that I know that they say it, but I do. Okay, and that's okay. I just play it up and let them enjoy themselves, okay? But here's the bottom line. I'm as uninterested as I can be in how much money we have. What I'm interested in is to be labeled as this church at Smyrna was labeled. You're in tribulation. You're being oppressed. You're in abject poverty, and they're lying about you. But by golly, you're rich in what matters. So let's take it one more step and we'll close. If you have individually what these poor, oppressed people have had today, then you can know you are rich. If you don't have what they had and you own the world, you're poor. So here's my encouragement today as I close. Choose to step in to the realm of riches as God defines riches today. Say, I'm done with the riches of man. I'm embracing today the riches of God. And how do you do that? You humble yourself before Him. And your guiding principle becomes faith in who Jesus is and what He's done for you. Become rich today. And then follow that up with obedience in the face of persecution that will come. Poor and suffering is no problem if you're rich in what matters. Rich in faith. Let's pray. Father God, would You call us to Your riches today. Riches in faith, riches in love, riches in peace. Father, I pray You'd give us a heart willing to suffer, a heart willing to endure, no matter how many or who wants to cancel us. That we'll be in the final analysis when You look at us, You'll say, oh, but they're rich. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. As you stand to your feet, be rich today in God's riches.
And I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. As Jesus made it all, and all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain.
Thank you for being here today. I want to remind you just a few pray for things and then a couple other instructions. Remember the George Kennedy family. That service was yesterday. Just remember to lift that family up in your prayers. Giovanna Ursum's mother, Lawana Kirby, passed away this past week. Her service is here tomorrow at 2. All right, remember that family. And I received a message on Friday. I haven't been able to talk about it, but I got a confirmation this morning that James Lance had passed away. And he's about my age. I think he was a year behind me in school. But I don't have any service details yet or anything. I just ask you to pray for that family. It was an unexpected, sudden thing. And so I just ask you to lift up that family in your prayers. Jerry King's at our hospital. And remember Jerry, he's improving, doing better. Today at 3, as Zach mentioned earlier, the deacon training. And then on the of course, the community service is Tuesday night, it's Tuesday night at Freewill at 7. But the Thanksgiving feed that we have from 10:30 to 12:30, there's sign-ups out there at Connection Corner for food and for labor. If you want to work, get signed up. All right, if you want to give food, let us know, because we got to order food today or tomorrow that we'll need that we don't get signed up for. So if you get a chance, go by there and sign up. And last night for D groups until January tonight. So have a good evening. All right, God bless you. You're dismissed.